journey with all of us. Now, it's time for Reverend Colliver to speak. Whatever happens to my old friend God?
Now, there are some people who, when they hear this message, say, hey, we've gone way beyond the edge. We've gone beyond the edge. And if you think that, if it feels that way to you, that you've gone beyond the edge, know that you can fly. So you're not going to, you are just going to find yourself in a deeper, a higher vibrational dimension. If you think that we're going beyond the edge. But I also want to say that before we get to that part that I consider is the edge, I want to talk about why I think it is difficult for us to do this, why we might have a problem doing this, why we carry some stuff that makes it a little difficult for us to reach that edge point. So if some of you have not been a part of Sunday school, I want to speak to those of you that are church people, that have been in church all of your life, that have been to Sunday school from the time you were 3 years old. That's what I want to speak to. So you guys can pretty much tune out on that if you do not have a history of Sunday school and church. So kick back in when we get to that place called God is Dead. Okay? All right, so that's when we'll get to that edge part. But right now, let's look at those of us that have been in Sunday school or in church our whole life carry a very interesting relationship with God. We have some pretty interesting information that we have absorbed back before our brain was developed, sometime between prior to 6 years old. So we took in some information, and we were also offered some rather interesting information that we not only absorbed, but we were told that this was true. Let's begin with God. God, we were told, was our Father, our Creator. We were the created ones. We are the children of God as the created ones. We were told that God lives in a place called heaven, somewhere up in the sky. And if we were real good, that meant that we would live with God in heaven for the rest of our life in this magnificent bliss. If we were not good, and since we had our own mother, father, we knew pretty much what was good and what wasn't. It wasn't a shock to us. And so if we were not good, there was an opposite to heaven, and that was called hell, and we would be in eternal punishment. Now, as that was a Protestant belief, if we were Catholic, we had an option. And that meant that we could be prayed out, paid out, and out into out of purgatory. And we would then be able to spend the rest of our eternity in bliss. Mary, Mother Mary, was also a part of the heaven environment. And little Catholic kids were invited and encouraged and told to pray to Mother Mary, Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. We're big on that hour of our death because that's where eternity extended. That's where we're going to spend eternity. So now we have God, Father, mother, Mary, and now God's only begotten Son. The only begotten Son, who sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, from whence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. Again, Jesus, you know, be there at the hour of our death and make sure that we get into heaven. Now, while we may have an understanding that these are spiritual beings, we call them Father, we call them Mother, and we call them the Elder Brother or the Son. What is that? What are those labels? What are those names? They are the referencing human beings. All of these are human names, and we have a sense of we can have a relationship with a human being, a father, a mother, an elder brother. We know what they do. We know what they're about. And we know how to have a relationship with our father, with our mother. We know what they expect of us. Now, this may be a little bit off the subject, but it is said that there are many of us who are on the planet at this time who have come for the purpose of healing family patterns. Abuse, both physical, sexual, mental, emotional abuse, plus other family history that has been carried for generation upon generation upon generation. We have come and said, stops with me. That's what our role is in a particular family. This stops with me. So now let's assume that someone is a part of this family who has come to heal a family pattern. You know that their life is pretty rugged. You know their life is pretty difficult, pretty traumatic. That child from Sunday school is going to be told that if you are real good and you pray to God to come and help me, to come and save me, does God come? What does a child think? There's something wrong with me. Nothing wrong with God. God is divine. God is God. God didn't show up. God didn't save me from the beating. God didn't save me from the abuse. I'm not enough. I'm wrong. I'm not enough. Now, you, at 40 years old, that is what. But at 3 years old, that's what you make up. 4 years old, 5 years old, that you make up. I'm not enough. I'm not enough. I'm not good. There's something wrong with me. And you know that sort of thing drives us for as long as we're in the physical body, that attitude drives us. And we make decisions based on that. That's the part that when I learned that really, I thought, oh, I don't mind carrying that. I just don't want to make decisions based out of I'm not enough or I'm not, you know. That is very deadly. That is very deadly for an adult. Okay. So we have adults walking around with this particular kind of experience and relationship with God. And if one has an abusive father, abusive mother, it makes it a little difficult to be referring to and having a loving relationship with God the Father. It's a little difficult to translate and to transfer that. So we carry, we have a sense of I only know how to have relationships with people, with human beings. I don't know how to have a relationship with God. And the thing is that if each one of us had a box of crayons right now and a piece of paper, And we were asked to draw a picture of God. It would pretty much show up. So we'd all pretty much show up with the same picture of God. Mary, the same thing. She would be blue. She had blue over her, wouldn't she? Okay. Now, Jesus, that's a little different. We either would get a baby in a manger or we'd get a man on a cross. Would be the focus of it, bless you. But we still have an image of a human being. We all have it. Okay, so 50 years ago, approximately, a couple of theologians came up with a conversation that said, get ready for it, God is dead. And I don't know if you were on the planet at that time, you might have seen, it was the front cover of Time magazine, God is dead. And if you read it, if you were available and old enough at that time and you read the article, it said, well, okay, God is not dead, but our concept, that old concept of God, that is what is dead. Okay, you might have heard that. Did you hear what the new concept was? No new concept came out because where we would have to go from that, we're not ready. We're not ready to do that. So we have an old concept that we already know doesn't work. God is not an old man. Everybody knows, even the evangelical belief is God is not an old man out of the sky. That's over. Well, what is God? Well, what began to surface after we found that this was no longer the concept that we would be experiencing, what we learned is God is within. Now, I think that most of us have a little difficulty with that. How is God within me? How does that work? Crown chakra, heart chakra. How is God like a little man within me that is available? We don't quite understand how God within me works. Or if any of you do understand, raise your hand. I want to know. How does God within you work? How does it work? We say all the time, and my granddaughters go to a 25,000 member church in Minneapolis. And when we were driving away from there, I said, so, because it's rather evangelical, and I said, so tell me, where is God? Not a moment's hesitation within. Within. They know that God is within. I did not dare to push him any further. So just exactly what does that look like? What does that feel like? And so, But they at least know that part. They know that God is within rather than God is up in the sky. We at least have it just a little bit closer to home. However, if when we listen to the name of the song, it's obvious, I want to have a personal relationship. I want to have a personal relationship with God. And it is close enough that we can. God is within. It is close enough to go there, but we don't walk and talk with it. We don't quite have that. We don't quite understand it. It's not, I want to love you, I want to know you, I want to be in a oneness relationship because I know that we are one with God, one with each other. I want to be in that relationship. So, you know where we're going now? You already, as they say, you see the train coming? Where are we? You see the train coming? Okay. We are going to have to shift from the old God is creator and we are the created children of God. We're going to have to shift from that into what is more compatible with unity let me broaden it out with new thought understanding. Because for the last 150 years, when new thought has been available to us, there's been a new concept of God. It's very quiet. It's very quiet. But there is a new concept of God that is in alignment with not only Christian or universal spiritual principles, but science. Some of you may remember that we all were Christian science when we first started out, and then Mary Baker Eddy, what we call copyrighted the name Christian Science. So we had to get up off of it. Ernest Holmes was able to kind of hold it by going with religious science. But we had to get up off the name of Christian Science, which is the name of our newsletter. And in meditation, Fillmore went in another direction. He went in the direction of oneness. We are one with God. We are one with all life. Unity means that we are one. So that rather than in the relationship between spirituality and science, we became unity. We became one with all life. I thought it was a good move. I wasn't there, but I thought it was a good move. But I didn't miss it. It's good. So let me give you the definition, unity's definition of God. Universal. That would be omnipresent. Creative. Universal, creative, intelligent. Omniscient, universal, creative, intelligent, loving, that's spiritual. We've added that. Spiritual, loving, life, energy, that is the life force vibrating in its own rhythmic formula of . If we only had one word that we would describe God, we would describe God as
love.
And from the Christian perspective, and if there was only one word that would describe God in terms of science, it would be
energy.
So God is not an old man up in the sky. God is not a father. God is energy. God is pure energy. And when we do our affirmation, we identify that energy as absolute good. Only one presence, one power in the universe, in my life. And if you hang around with people who are studying or looking at quantum physics, you know that we are holding the same space. There is nothing but energy. There's no place where God is not. There's no place where energy is not. God and I are one. God is all there is. God is energy. Loving, life, energy. Okay, now I think, you see, the difficulty is, since we were little kids growing up, God has always been a human being. Mary has always been a human being. Jesus has always been a human being in terms of what we hold. How do we establish a relationship with energy? So you see, we're going to have to make a shift in our perception of what is God. That's what I'm saying, that since we all carry that, we're going to have some difficulty making the shift to energy as a first step, but we're even going to go further than that. See, God, what we carry is God is that aspect of us as creator who has created us. God has created us. God is the creator who has created us. We are the created ones. We are the children. You already get that that's not going to work. All right. Anybody here want to hang on to that? we can't go there anymore. We've got to go somewhere else, because that has been the message of between 4 and 2,000 years. It's over now. It's over now. That aspect of God is dead. God is divine mind. God is creative, universal, loving, life, energy. So how do we wrap that into something that we can work with? Where do we go with that? And as I say, I think some of you are already there, and so we'll try to catch up here in a minute. With that, we I forgot something I wanted to mention, and which leads into this, and that is that I used to live next door to a church, and the missionaries would go out every Sunday or every day, and when they would come in, they'd come by my house, and I'd be sitting out there protecting my cat from this big old yellow tomcat that would come and beat them up. So I'd be out there, so they would stop. We would check off one more person. And so 5 or 6 times we sit out there together. They're telling me what they believe, and I'm looking at how I see that, how I believe it. Finally, after about the 6th or 7th session, I said, "Say, tell me your metaphysics about God." Your metaphysics about God, your metaphysics about you, and the relationship between you and God. And he said, "Oh, great. God is a human being who lives up in a particular solar system on a particular planet." That I was so shocked, I didn't get the name. What is the basis for that? And he said, "The Bible." Now, I'm not a Bible scholar, but I am a Bible student. And I could not think of anywhere in the Bible that said God is a human being. I couldn't think of it. So I said, "Oh, you know what? All right, I give up. Which particular scripture do you use?" We are created in the image and likeness of God. We are human beings. Therefore, God is a human being. So I started to laugh. You know, he said, "You know the scripture?" I said, "Yeah, I do know the scripture." But I said, "You know, I use the other end of it. I use the other end of it. God, there is, that we are created in the image and likeness of God. God is a spirit, therefore we are spiritual beings." And I thought, isn't it amazing that 10 little words, and we're at the opposite ends of the spectrum. But you see, and I have probably then totally realized that we all see God as a human being. Maybe not in another solar system. We see God, you know, that isn't quite so strange. That isn't quite so strange. There is that element of we are God. But when we identify God as divine mind, and you're in new thought now, God is divine mind, then we are created in the image of divine mind. We are an aspect. We are an individualized aspect, a part of divine mind. When we try to figure out how is God within us, we don't have any problem at all, because God is within us as mind. We have a mind. We have a consciousness. We have a level of consciousness. Whatever level of consciousness our mind is, our mind is in each and every cell of our body. If we are an individualized aspect of mind, it is within each and every aspect, each and every cell of our body. mind. And that's when the whole, when we look at the holistic pictures, it becomes very interesting to see the holistic part of mind. Now, when unity, they say, okay, God is within us, not as a hot dog in a bun. Not as a hot dog in a bun, but rather, if you go there, quit. It's not. But rather, God is within us, rather like a wave in the ocean. Kool-Aid. We are the wave, the individualized expression of God, like the wave is an individualized expression of the ocean. We are the individualized expression of God. We are creators. As God is divine mind, is the creator, we, as individualized expressions of that mind, we are the creators. We are creators. We create. Did you study the Course in Miracles? Does God create in the physical realm? God does not create in the physical realm. Who creates in the physical realm? We do. We are the creators in the physical realm, and we create divine through mind. Do we not? Don't you know how we create? Of course, we all know how we create. It is, we create through mind. God mind is created. We create through mind. We are the creators. We are the creators. John 10, know ye not that ye are gods? Do you not know that you are God? This is Old Testament. This is New Testament. We are, Jesus said, we are the individual. No, he didn't say that. Charles Stoneman said that. Sorry. Jesus said, the kingdom of God is within you. The kingdom of heaven is all around you. Right here, right now. You are in the kingdom of heaven. You manifest in the kingdom of heaven. And there's one more that I also like very much. The work that I do, you can do likewise. Even those of you who were raised in Sunday school remember that. Even greater things than this. This shouldn't be. It is rocket science, actually, you know, but this shouldn't be a surprise to us that we are God. That we are God. Now, I do have to admit, I wouldn't suggest that you go out there telling your friends. You know what I heard in church? I'm God. See, I was at the beauty shop getting my hair cut, sitting next to a lady who that Sunday had been at the same movie I was at, Shirley MacLaine. The movie where Shirley MacLaine is walking up and down the beach saying, I am God, God I am. The lady said, I will never see another, I will make sure not a dime of my money goes to supporting Shirley MacLaine. That was heresy. I am God is heresy. So I suspect that the majority of folks see I am God as heresy. Maybe you see, ooh, wow, you know, I'm suggesting that that's the truth. I'm suggesting it is biblical. I'm suggesting that it is scientific. I'm suggesting that it is common sense. And I still suggest that you don't go out saying, I am God. Okay? But you need to know it. You need to know it. We need to know it ourselves. I am God, and this is how I create. I can create everything. And as a matter of fact, we already know that we are creating through the power of the mind. We've seen some of the things that we've created through the power of the mind that require changing our thoughts, changing our agreement with our thoughts in order to get into an alignment with the one presence of the one power that we call God. It's a new belief that we have to adjust to in order for us to create our own personal world. And then when we come together, when we, a like mind, come together in the recognition, I am the creator of my personal world, and we come together, that multiplies that energy, and we can change the world. As a matter of fact, I don't think anything else will. I don't think the world will be changed by anything other than people of like mind who are creating love of the world. I think that's why we're here. At least we're here at the right time. We're here right at the beginning of the Aquarian energy, and the Aquarian energy is all about coming together as in community, coming together and creating. Creating magnificent expressions of love. I'm not going to ask you if you have any questions. I like to do that sometimes, but not today. Let's not go with question. But let's know that we are the creators. We are way beyond the created ones. We are the creators. And it is our responsibility to create that energy and activity of God that we call absolute good in each and every aspect of our life. And that multiplies into the world. Namaste. Someone back there, tell me what time it is. I can't see that.
Is it still broken?
It's still broken.
11:07.
Oh, okay. 11:07? Yeah. Let's just have a brief moment of meditation. Because this is the kind of idea, what meditation takes it deeper into our awareness. And so I invite you just to relax the physical body, to just still the mind. I invite you to breathe in the breath of spirit, that life-producing breath. I invite you to go into the center of your being, into that place that we call the mind. And to move beyond the place where we think consciously, to move to that place that Rumi calls the field where we will meet. Beyond that place of wrongdoing and rightdoing is a field. Come to that field. Meet in the field where there is just nothing but energy. The field of energy. And in this field, in this place, within mind, just hear the words, know ye not that you are God. Hear those words resonating in your heart. We are divine expressions of the energy and activity of God. Individualized expressions of God. In this moment, let's be willing to study this a little bit, to engage in how this might work for us in our life, and how it might be different for us to move from the concept of being a worm of the dust to being the energy and the activity of God. For this truth, we are grateful we get thankful.